Hi everyone, welcome to our session on the Accelerated 5-Year BSMS Program at Stony Brook University in Computer Science. I will go today over the program and tell you more about the requirements to apply and basically the advantages and disadvantages of the program. So I have wrote in fact a couple of slides that I will go over. And then I will pick up questions. And in fact, what I usually do, I go over and add additional slides to the FAQ slides at the end of this. And all of this is actually available on the BSMS program website. So you can always read everything that I will talk about on this website in even more detail that I'm presenting it here. I will not go into details how to submit applications for courses or all the documents that we need to complete. I will tell you a little bit about them, but once I present the overall idea of the program. So, first of all, why to go to grad school? And really the answer is that you want further education in computer science and further professional advancements resulting in increased paycheck, more job opportunities beyond software developers, because some jobs require advanced degrees. For instance, university professor, researcher, even now developer jobs in large companies like Google, Facebook require advanced degrees. It also provides an edge over other applicants. Basically, you have more experience on your resume, like work in a research lab, on a research project, teaching position, like a TA position, and it improves your marketable skills. So what exactly is grad school? It's another degree, a more advanced degree in computer science. Many of you may actually decide to continue with a PhD. Many actually did that. Some professors that you may have taken courses with went through this system. I went through this system. Professor McDonald's went through this system that basically got a bachelor and a master in basically one program, and they continued with PhD. What kind of jobs you can get with an MS, software developer, a programmer in a research lab, with a PhD, university professor, researcher at lab, research development and management at companies. It also in some way avoids getting a real job at least for a while, another year. Typically a master program takes 1.5 years or 2 years or 3 semesters to complete. The BSMS program is only 2 semesters after the bachelor. Basically 2 semesters for the MS part. The cost of a typical MS program is about 65K. That includes everything, tuition, fees, and so on. BSMS is obviously cheaper. It's in-state tuition for 2 more semesters. And while you are in the undergraduate bachelor phase, you may actually still continue with any financial aid that you get, like New York State financial aid, federal financial aid, because the courses that you will take, even graduate courses, they are incorporated in the bachelor program. So basically you will get a much cheaper master degree. Now there are decisions on when to go to grad school, and for that you have to think about what's the time commitment for grad school. MS degree is usually 1 to 2 years. In average is 1.5 and 2. The BSMS program is obviously a little bit shorter because it's you already took 9 credits of graduate courses while you are an undergraduate, which you can also use, you can double dip, you can use for both undergraduate and master degree. For a PhD, if you decide to basically do a PhD, I would say that the average is about 6 years. Very, very good students finish within 4, 5, 6. there are students that finish in 8 years or even longer. There are two options of when do you want to go to grad school. If you do a BSMS program, it's right after the bachelor. And the advantage of that is that you still have the momentum and discipline for school. You know how to take courses, exams. You have also fewer financial obligations. You don't have a family yet, children. But as a disadvantage is one more year of tuition. After a few years of work, and we have a lot of students that decide to come back after a while to do a master or a PhD, you have a different perspective on education, how important it is for jobs in industry. It also, you save dollars, money for school, or you get employer reimbursement. There are employers that actually pay for the master degree. We have several students that basically get their master degree reimbursed by companies like Bloomberg. You also get hands-on experience while working in industry, and then you know better what to do with the courses that you take as a grad student. However, it's hard to go back to school. Return back to study and tests is very hard. I saw it in my parents. They went back to school after working a couple of years, and it took them longer to graduate than if they would have went directly from bachelor. Also, there are financial sacrifices by others. You basically, it's not only you, like now in most cases, but you have family, children, and there is a difference between, for instance, stipend that you would get as a PhD student or as a master TA or master research student and a salary in industry, especially in computer science. What are the master degree requirements? So it's more courses. The master degree at Stony Brook is 31 credits, but you can take 9 credits as an undergraduate. So you must take at least 6 credits as an undergraduate of graduate courses, but up to 9 credits as an undergraduate. So basically you have left 22 credits left. And usually that takes 2 semesters, a full semester of 12 credits and another semester of 10 credits. There are 3 MS options at Stony Brook. One is called the basic option, and the basic option means that you take the required breadth of computer science courses that covers those part of those 31 credits, but one of the courses, a graduate course that you take, especially those with projects, you take a CSC 522 basic option master project. And basically for that one, the grade that you get in that class is the grade that applies to CSC 522. You do a project for that class, like basically most of the other students in the class. Most instructors don't ask for any additional requirements, but there may be instructors that may ask, but they will tell you at the beginning if they have additional requirements for the 522 students. The second option is the master project, which is actually a sequence of 2 courses, CSC 523 and CSC 524 in 2 sequential semesters, in which you work on a project with an advisor, and most students actually prefer to go through this option. I would say the 90% of students take the master project. They gain experience. They also, it's easier than taking a course for 2 courses or 1 course for 1 semester, and they work on a long-term project with that advisor. And in the end, sometimes they have to write a report, but in most cases it's just that basically you work on a project and you produce software for that advisor. If you are a BSMS student, it's usually easier because you can approach the faculty while you are in the undergraduate program and maybe work on over the spring break or the summer, And then you basically can just continue a project that you started as an undergraduate and do it as your master project. It's also okay if you just contact the potential advisors at the beginning of your master semester and you start working with an advisor. We have 56 faculty in the department, and most of the faculty take several students every semester. I think I have over 10 this semester. The master thesis is the third option. I believe the number is CSE 599, and it's basically a research project and a thesis. It's actually over 3 semesters. You have to take 9 credits of research thesis, and you basically work on a project over 3 semesters and produce a thesis, a report that is published by the university library. And you even get a book code for it. It's good for a future PhD. It helps you decide if you want to do a PhD or not, because mostly PhD papers are like that. You have to find a problem, work on it for a long time, and produce publishable results. There are also mixes of these options. So I've seen students that started with a research project 523, but then decided that I want to do a thesis, and then the following 2 semesters they did MS thesis, and then they combined it with the 523 to become a MS thesis. So the t 9 credits are not actually required to be all of for the thesis. You can do a project followed by the thesis. If you do 523 and 524, then you can't really choose anymore because you finish the require this requirement. So you can do 597, I believe, independent research, or 587, I believe. Okay. So, what's the accelerated BSMS program? Is this opportunity to finish the master in 1 additional year after your bachelor? And it's basically, it requires no GRE and no application fee. If you took a look at the application, it's quite simple. It's a Google form that you basically submit with all of the required parts, and we review it. And we basically let you know within 2 weeks if you are in the program or not. Another advantage is that you can withdraw at any time, and still the graduate courses that you took as an undergraduate count as undergraduate electives. So really there is no downside for this program that I see. As a graduate student, you will take courses, advanced courses with professors that you may know. Which may not be offered for undergraduate students, like computer architecture with Professor Furman. Some of you took cloud computing with him, operating systems with Professor Zadok, machine learning or computer vision with Professor Samaras, visualization with Professor Klaus Mueller, virtual reality with Professor Kaufman, and so on. We have a long list of faculty that work on interesting areas in computer science. Also, for the BSMS program, when we choose TAs, graduate TAs, the BSMS students have priority for TA scholarships. Also, something that I didn't mention, but it's here in the slide, is that we are currently ranked 31 in US News in graduate computer science. So, I have a couple of questions that were asked during the years. I've been in this position for 2 years, I believe now. And one question that everybody is asking is how many students are accepted. And in general, the only limit is qualified students. Every application has, first of all, we have the required the requirements that are on the website that you must have. A CSE GPA of 3.25, I believe, an undergraduate GPA of 3.2, I believe, but they are there on the website. Also, you must provide a good statement of purpose. Recommend you can you should ask for recommend 3 recommendations, 2 or 3 recommendations, And once every application is complete, I distribute it to randomly to faculty in the department, not the faculty that recommended you, but other colleagues of mine. And every application is reviewed by three faculty, and basically three different faculty, and then I render the majority decision to you as the applicant. And I can tell you that in most cases, these applications, these basically reviews are unanimous. Everybody agrees or disagrees if the student will be a good addition to the master program or not. Even if you get rejected from the BSMS program, you can still apply directly to the MS program. It's just that we don't recommend that you take undergraduate graduate classes as an undergraduate. So you should finish your bachelor and then get into the MS program and take all of the courses required for the MS program. Usually, just to tell you one more thing, if you do apply directly to the MS program, I believe that we waive the application fees. But Professor Himanshu Gupta is the graduate admission director. I'm only doing the BSMS part, and he will tell you more details about that. So what does the master portion entail? As I said, there are 31 credits of graduate courses. 90% of students take the MS project, the 2 semesters MS project. The rest of the students basically are split between master thesis and basic option. How soon can you apply and start taking graduate classes? As soon as you want and you're qualified for them. And I believe that in order to apply to the BSMS program, you must have some number of undergraduate higher level classes. I believe it's 3 undergraduate classes, 3 higher level, upper division, higher level classes, which don't include non-technical courses. So they have to be technical. They don't include CSE 300, 301, and 312. You must take courses like 303, 316, 310, 320, 373, 416, and so on. How late can you apply? You can apply up to 1 semester before graduation. And the reason for that is that you need to take at least 6 credits as 2 classes of graduate CSE classes before you graduate. So they count both for bachelor and master. Now, for bachelor, even if you did finish the required electives, you can still take the 6 credits of undergraduate of the graduate classes, and basically that's fine. You will not pay additional tuition. You will just pay the undergraduate tuition, or you get financial aid for the undergraduate tuition. You can take up to 3 graduate classes, 9 credits of graduate classes during your bachelor. And also those 3 can be used for BS graduation. I had the student last year that took 3 graduate classes and used them as electives. There are also classes that count for the required classes. Like for instance, if you take the graduate theory of computation, it applies also for the undergraduate theory of computation. And similar for, if you are on the old track, the graduate databases applies as CSE 305, and graduate operating systems applies as CSE 306. And similar other courses, although in most cases you should take the undergraduate version before you take the graduate class, because usually the graduate class is more advanced than the undergraduate version. But some of you may already know the material, maybe from self-study, you know algorithms, and then you can directly get the graduate algorithms version. The BSMS joint program versus the master program, just it's an easier application. There is no GRE required, which is required for all. Actually, this year I think the GRE is not required anymore because of COVID, but pandemic, but normally GRE is required for a master degree. This year is not required, but there is still an application fee. For the BSMS program, there is no application fee and no GRE required. Is it possible to apply into the program in the senior year? Yes, if you apply during your first semester, you can still take the 6 credits of graduate classes during your second semester, which is what is required by the graduate school. And I just had a student a few minutes ago asking exactly this question that is previous to last semester, can I just take the class, can I apply and get accepted in the program next semester? The answer is yes. Can you specialize into something specific while pursuing the master? Yes. For instance, in my case, I did parallel processing during my master degree, not at Stony Brook, but basically you can specialize in anything you want. In these days, you can do. We have, I believe, two certifications, data science and AI specializations. Available for master degrees, and I think you can basically work in any field you want, in security with Professor Shaker, Michaelis, or Nikiforakis, or you can do vision with Min Jungen or Dimitris Samaras. Is it still possible to join the program if you already graduated? No, unfortunately, the idea of the BSMS program is that you join while you are a bachelor student, and there are courses that apply for both degrees. So if you already graduated, you probably will not, you cannot be accepted in this BSMS program. I just heard a beep a couple of minutes ago. Probably was somebody that was trying to join without Gmail, without a stonybrook@.edu email, and that's basically probably because they graduated already. Which classes do you need to take before applying? You need to take three upper division technical CSE classes, and those do not include technical classes, do not include CSE 300, which is our writing course, CSE 301, which is our history course, or CSE 312, which is the legal social issues in computer science. So we recommend that you take technical classes. You have to take at least three, and you must take more than you must take at least three before you apply. What are the different types of the MS programs? As I told you earlier, there are three different types: basic option, the 2 semester project, and the thesis. Are all the graduate programs usually research oriented? And the answer is yes. Most courses that you will basically take will have a research component, either a project or some advanced material that really it's basically research oriented. We talked a little bit about applications, and I said that there are minimum requirements for admission, 3.25 for a CSE, and all of these applications are reviewed by three faculty. So it's really up to this faculty to decide if your application is good enough for a BSMS program. I can tell you that almost all the applicants that were admitted in the last 2 years that I was the undergraduate CSE BSMS coordinator had over 3.5, mostly higher. What type of career students get after this BSMS program? I collected a list of previous students that took the BSMS program and basically are now at other companies, and you can see that they either continued at large companies, and this is just the I went over the BSMS students, and there are not many. There are about 10 per year, and it was quite easy for me to find all of these people and where they are right now from LinkedIn and other websites. So Some of them continue with a PhD program, some of them continue working at big companies like Facebook, Google, Amazon, Intel, JP Morgan, and so on. So let's talk about the application process. The application process is a Google form which is available on the BSMS website. The application requires a resume, which is really one page resume about where you are currently in life, and the statement of purpose. And you should ask for permission from faculty that you took courses with or internship mentors for two or three recommendation letters. The statement of purpose is basically a statement. It's like the essay that you write for undergraduate admission, stating why getting an advanced degree, a graduate degree in computer science will be beneficial for your career. At least one recommendation must be from a current CS faculty member that will not be selected as as one of your three reviewers. And these recommendations can be emailed to the undergraduate secretary. We usually wait for the deadline on January 1st for spring admission, and I send an email to all of the recommenders to basically send the undergraduate secretary the recommendation letter. To be considered, applicants must complete three upper division computer science courses at Stony Brook with a GPA of 3.25 or higher, both overall and in computer science. In the past, most successful applicants had A's and B's in most upper division courses. So I talk with many of the faculty reviewers, and they are looking for grades of at least B in the required courses. Those are CSE 216, 316, 303, 375. Basically, they are looking that in required courses you have the background of at least an average computer science student. The deadline for the BSMS application is July 1st. That's for fall semester admission, and for spring semester admission is spring. It's January 1st. And as I said, all applications are reviewed within 2 weeks in most cases, and I will send the notifications after I get all of the reviews back. As an undergraduate, once you get admitted in the BSMS program, you can take up to three graduate computer science courses. And those three graduate computer science courses can be used for both credit in the undergraduate and the graduate degree. Each of these electives carries 3 credits, and you must get a grade of C or higher in order to be counted in both degrees. The grade that you get in these courses will count in both the GPAs for the undergraduate GPA and the graduate GPA. Now, so basically, there is the application. Then, as an undergraduate, we will basically have to fill paperwork for taking graduate courses. And for instance, this application has to be signed by both me as undergraduate advisor, BSMS coordinator, and the graduate director. But I usually get these signatures after I get your application. I get the signatures from the CS department and the graduate school. Once you finish in the semester before completing your undergraduate requirements, you have to apply for admission, basically transition to the MS program. And again, there is some paperwork that we need to complete. Basically, I have to check that you are in good standing, you finish your undergraduate degree, or you will finish your undergraduate degree if all courses are passed, and then we send it to the graduate school, which basically does admission in the graduate program. Now, As I said, there is no drawback. There is a form for withdrawal from the APP program. If you decide to not continue with a master program, actually the form on the graduate web, school website says that if you opt to withdraw from the accelerated program, you may choose to apply the graduate credits earned as part of your accelerated and combined program towards your undergraduate degree. This basically, BSMS program is a sequential degree. You finish the bachelor, you continue with master. But if you decide not to continue with master, you can still use your graduate credits as electives, CSE electives in the undergraduate program. And that's basically the presentation, in addition to all of the details that are on the website. On the website, I'm going into more details about what forms need to be completed, basically how do we compute the technical GPA, the technical CSE GPA, and so on. But I can take at this point questions from everyone if there are any questions. You can just unmute yourself or put the question in the chat, and I will try to respond to your questions.
When
When
you're
you're talking
talking
about
about like
what
what
years
years
to
to
do,
do,
you
you
mean
mean
solely
solely
like
like
credit
credit
standing,
standing,
right?
right?
So
So
like
like
say
say
we
we
like
like
had
had
the
the
credits
credits
to
to
graduate
graduate
in
in
3.5
3.5
semester or
or
like
like
3.5
3.5
years
years
or
or
something,
something,
we
we
would
would
just
just
apply
apply
the
the
semester
semester
before.
before.
You can apply up to the semester before, yes.
Yeah,
Or
or
two
two
semesters
semesters
before, or
before.
two
So
semesters
like
before, or three semesters before. At the moment, that basically you need three upper division classes by the time that we review your application. So if you're
okay.
currently taking, let's say, the third one or two of the three, you can apply, because by the time that we get your application, we will basically get the grade in that class. Okay. Next question.
So in
So in
terms
terms
of
of
working
working
on
on
a
a project
project with
with
another
another
professor,
professor,
would
would
that
that
be
be
strictly
strictly
limited
limited
to
to
within
within
the
the
CS
CS
department?
department?
Or
Or
let's
let's
say
say
there
there
is
is
a
a
student
student
who
who
wanted
wanted
to
to
work
work
with
with
a
a
professor
professor
in
in
the
the
biomedical
biomedical
informatics
informatics
department,
department,
or
or
a
a
professor
professor
in
in
the
the
CS
CS
department
department
who's
who's
collaborating
collaborating
with
with
the
the
professor
professor
in
in
the
the
biomedical
biomedical
informatics
question.
department?
So we have this question all the time, even from PhD students. What we created is something called affiliated professors. Basically, professors in other departments that can direct students in the computer science department. So, and because we need, you are still a computer science student, so we want to make sure that your project is in computer science. So if the faculty that you are not, that you are thinking of working with is not yet in the affiliated list, please contact me, and I will basically try to contact that professor to make sure that he is at least affiliated with computer science. I will There is an application that there is a process that that person has to go through to basically advise students in our department. So many of the students in our department in computer science are advised from applied math professor Joe Mitchell or Esther Arkin, or they are advised by professors in biomedical informatics like Professor Joe Saltz, Fusheng Wang, and so on. Even if they are not core computer science, that means that they are not hired in computer science department, they can still advise students, bachelor, undergraduate, graduate. And basically what they need is a section of these courses, 523 and CSE 524, in computer science. So basically they need some kind of official way to direct students in computer science. And you can directly contact me, or you can talk with that professor. Maybe he already started this process. Okay, next question. go ahead.
Professor, so for the resume, aside from like the obvious stuff like education and experience, is there anything else that we should be listing on there as well?
Not really. I would say that basically if you did a project in a course, if you did an internship and a high level description of the internship that basically is accepted by that place that we worked in, because most companies have some non-disclosure agreement. So before you leave the internship, you can ask your mentor officially through email, and then you save it that, can I list this sentence in my resume saying that not only that you worked for company X, but I did this website development for company X or this program for company X. And usually they accept. Now there were cases when I've seen, we have a requirement that if students take credit for the internship, the company has to submit a review, which is not even technical. It's just saying that the student completed the internship successfully. And I had companies basically saying that no, you can't do that because but it's totally nonsense from my opinion, because the question is not even, it's just, did this person finish the internship? It was not much else. And it's kind of like a requirement in many cases for international students which need an OPT, optional practical training, that for working outside the campus for the internship. So I don't know if they realize, but it is a federal requirement that the university is the one that gives the visa, and it has to be part of the curriculum, otherwise they can't employ that student. So I've seen cases in which the company was totally irrational, that they would say, no, you can't say anything. But in the same time, you do understand that they probably are afraid of competition. So it has to be, that's why I'm saying that it's quite important that you ask for permission before you complete your internship, just to make sure that it's not something that they don't like.
Okay, understood. And is there also a recommended limit to the resume? Like, is it strictly one page, or can it like be more?
1 to 2 pages. That's what usually a resume is.
Okay. And last question from me. So when we gather our recommenders, is there a specific email they should be expecting from when you reach out to them for the letters of recommendation, or is it the CSUG com one?
I have this little statement that states what a recommendation letter should be.
No. I'm saying, like, what email will you reach out to them through, like, specifically?
pfodor@cs.stonybrook.edu.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Welcome. Other questions?